guys, so in today's video we'll be looking into the US hegemony in world politics. Okay, overview. We have seen that the end of Cold War left US without any serious rivals. It was the war between Soviet Union and the US, but there was not actually any war, just defensive arrangements. The era since then has been described as a period of US dominance or a unipolar world. Unipolar means there is only single superpower, that is US, because the USSR had collapsed. In this chapter, we will try to understand the nature, extent and the limits of this dominance. We begin by narrating the story of the rise of the new world order from the first Gulf War to the US-led invasion of Iraq. Okay. We then pause to understand the nature of US domination with the help of the concept of hegemony. After exploring the political, economical and cultural aspects of US hegemony, we assess India's policy. This is the most crucial part. India's policy options in dealing with US. Finally, we turn to see if there are challenges to this hegemony and whether it can be overcome. Now, before we begin the chapter, you need to look into a story of Aisha, Jabu and Andre. Okay, Aisha is doing very well in her studies at a high school in the outskirts of Baghdad in Iraq. Okay, was planning to study medicine in university. She lost a leg in 2003 when a missile slammed into an air raid shelter in which she was hiding with her friends. Now, she is learning to walk all over again. She still plans to become a doctor, but only after the foreign armies leave her country. Okay, we will see what happened in Iraq and all. Okay, Jabu is a talented young artist who lives in Durban, Africa, South Africa. His paintings are heavily influenced by traditional tribal art forms. He wants to go to an art school and later open his own studio. However, his father wants him to study for an MBA and then join the family business. The business is not doing too well. Jabu's father feels that with an MBA degree, Jabu will be able to make family business profitable. Now, Andre. Andre is a young man living in Perth, that is in Australia. His parents are immigrants from Russia. His mother gets very angry every time Andre puts on blue jeans and go to church. She wants him to look respectable in church. Andre tells his mother the jeans are cool and they give him the sense of freedom. Andre's father reminds his wife how they used to wear jeans when they were youngsters in Leningrad, and for the same reason that their son now invokes. Andre has had an argument with his mother. Jabu may be forced to study a subject that he has no interest in, that is, he is forced to study MBA rather than his interest in painting, okay, or in art. In contrast, Aisha has lost her leg and is lucky to be alive. How can we even discuss these problems in the same breath? Okay, we can and must do so. There is a common link. Okay, and all that is affected by US hegemony. We will meet Aisha, Jabu and Andre again. Okay, but let us first understand how US hegemony began and how it operates in the world today. We'll follow the popular usage of the word America, okay, to refer to the United States of America. Okay, but it may be useful to remind ourselves that expression America, it actually refers to both the continents of North and South America, and US is only a country in the northern continent. But when we refer to America, we usually refer it to United States. Okay, that is another dominance of the United States. Okay, beginning of the new world order. The sudden collapse of the Soviet Union took everyone by surprise. Okay, it was actually an internal issue that led to the fall of Soviet Union. While one of the two superpowers ceased to exist, the other remained with all its powers intact. Okay, even enhanced. Thus, it would appear that the US hegemony began in 1991 after Soviet power disappeared from the international scene. This is largely correct, but we need to keep in mind two riders to this. Okay, first, we shall see in this chapter some aspects of US hegemony did not emerge in 1991. But in fact, go back to the end of the Second World War in 1945. Second, the US did not start behaving like a hegemonic power right from 1991. It became clear much later that the world was in fact living in a period of hegemony. Okay, in the initial stages, it was not clear. In August 1990, Iraq invaded Kuwait, rapidly occupying and subsequently annexing it. Okay, after a series of diplomatic attempts failed at convincing Iraq to quit its aggression, United Nations mandated the liberation of Kuwait by force. So what happened? For the UN, this was a dramatic decision after years of deadlock during the Cold War. Okay, the US President George W. Bush, H.W. Bush, hailed the emergence of a new world order. A massive coalition force of 660,000 troops from 34 countries fought against Iraq and defeated in what came to be known as the First Gulf War. However, UN operation, which called the Operation Desert Storm, was overwhelmingly American. Nearly 75% of the coalition forces were from the US. Although the Iraqi president Saddam Hussein had promised mother of all battles, the Iraqi forces were quickly defeated and forced to withdraw from Kuwait. Okay. The First World War revealed the vast technological gap that had opened up between the US military capability and that of the other states. The highly publicized use of so-called smart bombs by US led some observers to call this a computer war. Widespread television coverage has also made it a video game war, with viewers around the world watching the destruction of Iraqi forces live on TV in the comfort of their living rooms. Incredibly, the US may actually have made a profit from the war. According to many reports, US received more money from the countries like Germany, Japan, and Saudi Arabia than it had spent on war. Now, Clinton years. Okay, despite winning the first Gulf War, George H.W. Bush lost the US presidential elections. Then who came? Then Bill Clinton came. He was a candidate from the Democratic Party who had campaigned at domestic rather than for foreign policy issues. Bill Clinton won again in 1996 and thus remained the president of US for 8 years. During Clinton years, it often seemed that the US had withdrawn into its internal affairs and was not fully engaged in world politics. In foreign policy, the Clinton government tended to focus on soft issues like democracy promotion, climate change, and world trade rather than on the hard politics of military power and security. Nevertheless, the US on occasion did show its readiness to use military power even during Clinton years. The most important episode occurred in the response to Yugoslavian actions against the predominantly Albanian population in the province of Kosovo. Okay, the air forces of the NATO countries led by the US bombarded targets around Yugoslavia for well over 2 months, forcing the downfall of the government of Slobodan Milosevic and the stationing of NATO forces in Kosovo. Okay, another significant US military action during Clinton years was the response of the bombing of US embassies in Nairobi, Kenya, and Dar es Salaam in Tanzania in 1998. These bombings were attributed to Al-Qaeda, a terrorist organization strongly influenced by Islamist extremism. Okay, within a few days of this bombing, President Clinton ordered an Operation Infinite Reach, a series of cruise missile strikes on Al-Qaeda terrorist targets in Sudan and Afghanistan. The US did not bother about the UN sanction. UN was all there, but they didn't care about UN. Okay, because the majority of the funding for UN comes from US. It was alleged that some of the targets were civilian facilities unconnected to terrorism. In retrospect, this was merely the beginning. Okay, now before we go, this is the picture of when the Iraq invaded Kuwait. Okay, this is called Highway of Death. Okay, and now we come to the September 11 incident. That is a global war on terror. Okay, on 11 September 2001, 19 hijackers hailing from a number of Arab countries to control of four American commercial aircraft. So in 19 hijackers, even though the war was fought in Afghanistan, aftermath of the 9/11 was fought in Afghanistan, there was not even a single Afghan citizen in these 19 hijackers. Okay, that should be noted. One airliner each took off and flew them into important buildings in the US. One airliner each crashed into the north and south towers of the World Trade Center in New York. A third aircraft crashed into the Pentagon building in Arlington, Virginia, okay, where the US Defense Department is headquartered. The fourth aircraft, presumably bound for the Capitol building of the US Congress, came down in the field in Pennsylvania. Okay, the attacks came to be known as 9/11, because in according to the US tradition, dates, months are written first. Okay, attacks killed nearly 3,000 people. In terms of the shocking effect on Americans, they have been compared to the British burning of Washington DC in 1840 and the Japanese attack on the Pearl Harbor in 1941. However, in terms of loss of life, it was the most severe attack on US soil since the founding of the country in 1776. So another thing to be noted, this is the image of the New York Times newspaper when the attack happened. Okay, coming back, the US response to 9/11 was swift and ferocious. The Clinton had been succeeded in the US presidency by George W. Bush of the Republican Party. They are mainly conservatives. Son of the earlier president George H.W. Bush. Unlike Clinton, Bush was a much harder view of US interest and of the means by which to advance them. As part of the global war on terror, the US launched Operation Enduring Freedom against all those suspected to be behind this attack, mainly Al-Qaeda and the Taliban regime in Afghanistan. The Taliban regime was easily overthrown, but remnants of the Taliban and Al-Qaeda have remained potent. And finally, they came into power in the recent times. Okay. The US forces made arrests all over the world, often without the knowledge of the government of the persons being arrested. Suppose they sent agents and arrest a person living in Iraq without the consent of the Iraqi government. Just like that, they go in and they barge in and they arrest them. Okay. Transported these persons across countries and detained them in secret prisons. Some of them were brought to Guantanamo Bay, a US naval base in Cuba, where the prisoners did not enjoy the protection of the international law or the law of their own country or that of the US. Even the UN representatives were not allowed to meet these prisoners. Okay. This is a very interesting cartoon. This one, basically. So, we will start with this. A foreign country is there. It is a democratic country. If it is not friendly with US, what happened? If it has a lot of oil and mineral wealth, then the US will claim that it has nukes, then harass economically until it becomes friendly. Okay. Or what happens? Or if it has no nuclear weapons, then find pretexts that there are something and inhuman things going on or people are not happy. Then they invade and install a pro-US puppet government or provoke civil war in this. And finally, the state becomes a failed state. Okay. And provoking uprising. Okay, that's it. In the second case, if it is a democratic country and it is a friendly nation to US, what happened? They interact in as profitable as manner. They want a profit. If they are friendly with you, they want a profit. Now, apart from democracy, if the country is in a dictatorship and it is not friendly to US, what happened? Then if it has a lot of oil and mineral wealth, then and if it has no nuclear wealth, then find a pretext and invade. The same scenario. And if it is poor and no oil, no nukes, no crisis is there, then ignore. No media attention. Okay. That is the flowchart. It's a funny flowchart, but it's quite a reality. The Iraq invasion. In 19th March 2003, The US launched its invasion on Iraq under the codename Operation Iraqi Freedom. More than 40 other countries joined the US-led coalition of the willing after the UN refused to give its mandate to the invasion. See, the permission of UN was not there. Still, they joined and they prepared to fight. The ostensible purpose of the invasion was to prevent Iraq from developing weapons of mass destruction. But since no evidence of weapons of mass destruction has been unearthed in Iraq, it was speculated that the invasion was motivated by other objectives, such as controlling Iraqi oil fields and installing a regime friendly to the US. Okay, which eventually backfired in the recent times with the emergence of Islamic State. The emergence of Islamic State, we can say that it was actually the unrest that created in the country that resulted in the emergence of Islamic State, rather than the religious aspect. Religious aspect is also there, but major cause was that they created a social divide between the peoples in the country, especially between Shias and Sunnis. Okay. Although the government of Saddam Hussein fell swiftly, the US has not been able to pacify Iraq. Actually, Saddam Hussein, to some extent, he maintained a proper law and order. Even though he was a dictator, there was a proper law and order in the country. But that was driven off when the US invaded Iraq. Instead, a full-fledged insurgency against US occupation was ignited in Iraq. While US has lost over 3,000 military personnel in the war, Iraqi casualties are much higher. It's conservatively estimated 50,000 Iraqi civilians have been killed since the US-led invasion. Okay, it is now widely recognized that the US invasion of Iraq was in some crucial respects both military and political failure. And do they care? No. What does hegemony mean? Politics is about power, just as individuals want to gain and retain power. Groups too want to gain and retain power. We routinely talk of someone becoming powerful or someone doing something for power. In case of world politics too, countries and groups of countries are engaged in constantly trying to gain and retain power. This power is in the form of military domination, economic power, political clout, and cultural superiority. Okay. Now, therefore, if we wanted to understand world politics, it is necessary that we understand the distribution of power among the countries in the world. For instance, during the years of Cold War, it was divided between two groups, that is the US and the Soviet Union. Okay, it represented the two camps or centers of power in the international politics during the period, that is socialism and capitalism, we can say. The collapse of Soviet Union left the world with only a single power, the United States of America. Sometimes the international system dominated by a sole superpower or hyperpower is called unipolar. Now we come to the definition of unipolarity. Okay. Now, this appears to be a misapplication of the idea of pole derived from physics. It may be more appropriate to describe an international system with only one center of power by the term hegemony. Okay, hegemony refers to when there is only properly one single center of power. We can identify three very different understandings of what hegemony is. Let us examine each of these meanings of hegemony and relate them to contemporary international politics. Hegemony as hard power. The roots of word hegemony lie in classical Greek. The word implies the leadership or predominance of one state and was originally used to denote the preponderance of possession of Athens. What happens in the ancient Greek, the Athens, the city-state of Athens was a well-developed state, we can say. Okay, first meaning of hegemony relates to relations, patterns and balances of military capability between states. It is this notion of hegemony as military prudence that is especially germane to the current position of the role of US in world politics. Okay, now what happened? Now we come to the first story initially that we said. Do you remember Aisha, who lost her leg in the American civil attack, missile attack? It is hard power hegemony that had broken Aisha's body, if not a spirit. The bedrock of contemporary US power lies in the overwhelming superiority of its military power. American military dominance today is both absolute and relative. In absolute terms, the US today has military capabilities that can reach any point on the planet accurately, lethally, and in real time. In fact, when Osama bin Laden was there, there was a mission to kill Osama bin Laden. It is said that they fired a missile from the Arabian Sea region, and it went through the hole of the or the window of the house in which bin Laden was staying. Okay, that much accuracy is there in their military capability, thereby crippling the adversary while its own forces are sheltered to the maximum extent possible from the dangers of war. But even more awesome than the absolute capabilities of the US is the fact that no other power today can remotely match them. US spends more than its military capability than the next 12 powers combined. Furthermore, a large chunk of the Pentagon's budgets goes into the military research and development. In other words, technology. Thus, the military dominance of US is not just based on higher military spending, but also on quality gap. Proper quality is there. A technological chasm, and no other power can at present conceivably span. Undoubtedly, the US invasion of Iraq reveals several American vulnerabilities. The US has not been able to force the Iraqi people to submit to the occupation of forces of the US-led coalition. Even though they invaded and finally won the war, they could not bring the spirit of Iraqi people down. We can say like that. Okay, to fully understand the nature of American weakness, however, we need to have a historical perspective. Imperial powers through history have used military forces to accomplish only four tasks. What are they? To conquer, deter, punish, and police. As the Iraq invasion shows, the American capacity to conquer is formidable. Okay, they can properly conquer you. Similarly, the US capability to deter and to punish is self-evident. When US military capability has thus far been shown to have serious weaknesses is in policing an occupied territory. Maintaining law and order, all these kinds after the invasion is very hard for US. Hegemony as structural power. We had looked into the hard power aspect, now structural power. The second notion of hegemony is very different from that of the first. It emerges from a particular understanding of the world economy. The basic idea is that an open world economy requires a hegemon or dominant power to support its creation and existence. The hegemon must possess both the ability and the desire to establish certain norms or order, and must sustain the global structure. The hegemon usually does this to its own advantage, but often it's relatively determined as its competitors take advantage of the openness of the world economy without paying the cost of maintaining its openness. Hegemony in this second sense is reflected in the role played by US in providing global public goods. By public goods, we mean those goods that can be consumed by one person without reducing the amount of goods available for someone else. Okay. Fresh air and roads are examples of public goods. Okay. Before that, we go into detail, we look into the defense budgets of top 15 countries. Here we can see that around $602 billion are spent on defense in United States, while in China it's $150 billion, in Saudi Arabia it's $76 billion, Russia it's $61 billion, and fifth is India with $52.5 billion. Okay, United Kingdom is $50 billion, rest all is there. And see this, when all are combined, it is nearly $700 billion, while US alone it's $600 billion. Okay, that is the difference, the gap between the spending in defense expenditure. In the extent of world economy, the best examples of a global public good are sea lanes of communication, sea routes commonly used by merchant ships. Free trade is an open world in an open world economy would not be possible without open sea routes. Okay. It is the naval power of the hegemon that underwrites the law of the sea and ensures freedom of the navigation in international waters. Okay, since the decline of the British naval power after the World War, what happened? The US Navy has played this role. Another example of the global public good is that of the internet. See, the internet is actually a research, military research product of the US, outcome of the US military research product. Even today, internet lies as a global network of satellites, most of which are owned by the US government. Okay, as you know, US is present in all parts of the world, in sectors of the world economy, and in all areas of technology. The US share of the world economy remains enormous, 21%. US also accounts for almost 14% of the world trade. If intra-European Union trade is included in world trade data, there is also a single sector of the world economy in which there is not a single sector in the world economy in which American firm does not feature in the top three list. Okay, it is important to remember that the economic preponderance of the US is inseparable from its structural power, which is the power to shape the global economy in a particular way. After all, the Bretton Woods system set up by the US after the Second World War still constitutes the basic structure of the world economy. The world economy is actually based on the US system. Okay. The bank, the International Monetary Fund, the World Trade Organizations are all products of American hegemony. Okay. A classic example of the structural power of the US is academic degree called Masters in Business Administration. The idea that business is a profession that depends upon skills that can be taught in a university is uniquely American. The first business school in the world, the Wharton School at the University of Pennsylvania, was established in 1881. The first MBA courses was initiated around 1900. The first MBA course outside US was established in 1950. Today, there is no country in the world in which MBA is not a prestigious academic degree. This takes us back to our South African friend, Jabu. Structural hegemony explains why Jabu's father is insisting that his son gives up painting and studies for MBA instead. Okay, now we come to the hegemony as soft power. It would, however, be a mistake to see US hegemony in purely military and economic terms without considering the ideological or the cultural dimension of the US hegemony. This third sense of hegemony is about the capacity to manufacture consent, okay, to comply with US norms. Okay, here, hegemony implies class ascendancy in the social, political, and particularly ideological spheres. Hegemony arises when the dominant class or country can win the consent of dominated classes by persuading the dominant classes to view the world in a manner favorable to the ascendancy of the dominant class. Okay, you need to apply it by the viewpoint that is created by the dominant class, adapted in the field of world politics. This notion of hegemony suggests that a dominant power deploys not only military power but also ideological resources to shape the behavior of competing and lesser powers. The behavior of the weaker countries is influenced in the ways that favor the interest of the most powerful country. In particular, this desire to remain prominent, consent in other words, goes hand in hand with and is often more effective than coercion. This basically means that whenever the dominant power or a more powerful entity or a powerful country asserts power on a less powerful country, the less powerful country often has to obey that also or give permission to that orders. Okay. The predominance of US in the world today is based not only on military power and economic powers, but also on its cultural presence. Whether we choose to recognize the fact. Now we come to the Andre case. Okay. In the initial story, most of the dreams of individuals and societies across the globe are dreams churned out by practices prevailing in the 20th century America. America is most seductive and in this case the most powerful culture on earth. This attribute is called soft power, the ability to pursue rather than coerce. Over time, we get used to hegemony that we hardly notice it any more than we notice the reverse birds and trees around us. We couldn't have forgotten Andre and his cool pair of jeans. When his parents were youngsters in the Soviet Union, what happened? Blue jeans were the ultimate symbol of liberation for their generation. Young men and women often spent over a year's salary to buy Yeah, blue jeans from foreign tourists on the black market. Somehow, for an entire survey generation, blue jeans came to represent aspirations of good life that were not available in their own country. During the Cold War, the US found it difficult to score victories against the Soviet Union in the realm of hard power. So, by militaristically, the Soviet Union was almost equal to that of US. Okay. It was in the area of structural power and soft power that the US scored notable victories. Although the Soviet centrally planned economy provided an alternate model to the internal economic organization, the world throughout the Cold War years remained a world of capitalist economy. Now we come to see the clash between capitalism and socialism. But it was in the area of soft power that the US was ultimately triumphant. As the example of blue jeans in the Soviet Union clearly shows, the US was able to engineer a generational divide in Soviet society on the basis of cultural product. Now, constraints in American power. Okay, history tells us that empires decline because they decay from within. Similarly, biggest constraints to American hegemony lie within the heart of hegemony itself. We can identify three constraints on American power. None of these constraints seem to operate in the years following 9/11. However, it now appears that all three of these constraints are slowly beginning to operate again. First constraint. What are these constraints? First one is the institutional architecture of the American state itself, a system of division of powers between the three branches of the government, places significant brakes upon the unstrained and immoderate exercise of America's military power by executive branch. The second constraint on American power is also the domestic in nature and stems from the open nature of American society. Although the American mass media may from time to time impose or promote a particular perspective of domestic public opinion in the US, there is nevertheless a deep skepticism regarding the purposes and methods of government in American political culture. Okay, this factor in the long run is a huge constraint in US military action overseas. However, it is the third constraint on the US that is perhaps the most important. There is only one organization in the international system that can possibly moderate the exercise of American power today. That is what? The North Atlantic Treaty Organization, or NATO. The US obviously has an enormous interest in keeping the alliance of democracies that follow the market economies alive, and therefore it's possible that its allies in the NATO will be able to moderate the exercise of US hegemony. Now we come to India's relationship with the US. During the Cold War years, India found itself the opposite side of the divide with US. From the US, India's closest friend during those years was the Soviet Union. After the collapse of the Soviet Union, India suddenly found itself friendless in an increasingly hostile international environment. However, there were also the years when India decided to liberalize its economy and integrate it with the world economy. This policy of India as impressive economic growth rates in recent years have made the country an attractive economic partner for a number of countries, including the US. It is important that we do not lose sight of the fact that two new factors have emerged in Indo-US relations in recent years. These factors relate to the technological dimension and the role of Indian-American diaspora. Indeed, these two factors are what? Interrelated. Consider the following facts. The US absorbs about 65% of India's total exports in the software sector, and 35% of the technical staff of Boeing is estimated to be of Indian origin. Now, 3 lakh Indians work in Silicon Valley. Now, 15% of all the high-tech startups are by Indian Americans. Like all other countries, India too has to decide exactly what type of relationship it wants with the US in this phase of global hegemony. The choices are not exactly easy. Within India, the debate seems to be around 3 possible strategies. First one, those Indian analysts who see international politics largely in terms of military power are fearful of the growing closeness between India and US. Okay, these are the analyst viewpoints. Okay, they don't want India to be close to the US. They prefer that India maintains its aloofness from Washington and focuses upon increasing its own comprehensive national power. Second analyst, see that the growing convergence of the interest between US and India has a historic opportunity for India. They advocate on strategy that would allow India to take advantage of US hegemony and the mutual convergences to establish the best possible option for itself. Opposing the US, they argue, is a futile, means worthless. Okay, futile strategy that will only hurt India in the long run. Now, the third and the last group of analysts would advocate that India should take the lead in establishing coalition countries from the developing world. At the time, this coalition would come more powerful and may succeed in weaning the hegemon away from its dominating world. Suppose India becomes the leader of the developing world, we can tackle this hegemony. That's what the third analyst is saying. Okay, India-US relations are perhaps too complex to be managed by single strategy. India needs to be to develop an appropriate mix of foreign policy strategies to deal with the US. Now, how can hegemony be overcome? Or how do you tackle US supremacy to some extent? Okay, how long will hegemony last? How do we get beyond hegemony? These become, for obvious reasons, some of the burning questions of our time. History provides us with some fascinating clues to answer these questions. What about present and the future? What about present and future? In international politics, very few factors formally curtail the exercise of military power by any country. There is no world government like government of a country. Okay. Now, international organization is not world government. Thus, international politics is politics without government. There is no responsibility. There are some rules and norms called the laws of war that restrict but do not prohibit war. But few states will entrust their security to international law alone. But that does not escape them, make them immune to hegemony. In the short term, we must recognize that no single power is anywhere near balancing the US militarily. A military coalition against US is even less likely given the differences that exist among big countries like China, India and Russia that have the potential to challenge US hegemony. All these three countries have differences. Okay, we all know what are the differences between China and India, and also China and Russia and India and Russia. A military coalition is nearly impossible. Some people argue that it is strategically more prudent to take advantage of the opportunities that hegemony creates. For instance, rising economic growth rates requires increased trade, technology transfers and investment, which are best acquired by working with rather than against the hegemon. Okay, we need to be friends. We need to be in a proper economic relationship with the US. Thus, it is suggested that instead of engaging in activities opposed to the hegemonic power, it may be advised to extract benefits by operating within the hegemonic system. This is called bandwagon strategy. Another strategy open to states is to hide. This implies staying as far removed from the dominant power as possible. Some like China, Russia, European Union, all of them are some examples. Okay, but how long? That is a question. Okay. This is a image of super world power stage. We can see China coming into the picture now. Okay. While it may be attractive, viable policy for small states. So small states, it's fine. Hiding from dominant power of the US is fine. It's hard to imagine mega states like India, China and Russia, or huge union of states like European Union being able to hide from any substantial length of time. Some people believe that resistance to American hegemony may not come from other states, but we have seen are powerless to confront the US today, but rather from non-state actors. These challenges to American hegemony will emerge in the economic and cultural lens, and will come from combination of NGOs, social movements, public opinion. It may arise from sections of the media and intellectuals, artists and writers. these various actors, what they do, may well form links across national boundaries, including with Americans, to criticize and resist US policies. We might even heard saying that we live in a global village. Okay. Vasudeva Kudumbakam. Okay. Another important aspect that we put in our, in Indian foreign policy, is Vasudeva Kudumbakam, a global village or global home. In this global village, we are all neighbors of the village headman. If the behavior of the headman becomes intolerable, we will not have the option of leaving the global village. We cannot leave the village because this is the only world we know and the only village we have. Resistance will be the only option available. So that is it for today's lecture about US hegemony. I hope today's section was productive for you guys. Until next time, we meet again. God bless you all. Jai Hind.